Okay, so as mentioned earlier by Koen, our APIs for AV Number went live a couple of weeks ago, as well as the developer portal. And since then, we are very eager to hear feedback from our developers. And in fact, despite a limited offering, we already have some developers that asked very good questions and actually pointed out some issues on the portal that we have. So we really think that developers are really the proof of the pudding for us, and we can, despite our best efforts, they are the ones that need to decide whether our portal is decent, and that really helps them to develop applications. So we had some emails from some developers, but of course a lot of developers are just interacting with our APIs and we never hear from them. So we're thinking that actually these guys are, in a sense, they're interacting with us constantly. Hopefully not like this, but maybe some of them are. So we thought, how can we capture actually this interaction? And in a sense, it's kind of easy to do. We can simply store all the input and output that we receive during these calls. But we will probably end up in this situation where we cannot really make sense of this amount of data. So we need some tooling that allows us to categorize this and make it searchable. So there are some tools available for this in the market. There are some open source options, which are actually quite great, and some commercial products. Within AV Number, we have adopted Splunk a couple of years ago, and some of my colleagues from the ESB will know that we are actually using that extensively there. So for this exercise, we are using Splunk. So what it allows us to do is to turn just bare raw data like this, and we can make it into maybe a pie chart that shows for a given time period what is the status response coming from our environment, from our APIs. And we can then zoom in on this data and say, let's look at this in a table form, and we can say, okay, let's see what kind of, how many 400 status codes are being returned from the pets API in this case. We can see it's actually quite a lot, actually more than the 200 range code, so maybe this is not what we want. But we can also expect that maybe this 185 counts are caused by maybe that first guy that's causing a lot of problems. So we can easily dive into the data and add the number of unique developers that are actually experiencing this, and then we can see that actually the majority in this example, majority of developers are doing pretty well. If we now want to say, how did these 18 or these 21 developers, how did they get to this status, this result, we can zoom in on that and we can say, let's look at all the consecutive events that started with a 400 status code, which is an error code that the developer needs to do something to fix it. And we look at all the events until he reached the 200 style code. And we can also see the status codes that he encountered in between, and we can see how long it took him to reach this success code. So in this case, it's one developer who has done this sequence of moving from an error state into a successful state a few times, so we can see the different durations. And we can also think about turning this into a sort of KPI, because we can say the shorter this duration, the better. And also we don't want actually a whole string of 400 codes that the developers experiencing, because maybe we can improve on the documentation or maybe on the error description. So what this also allows us to do is to see the last state. We can see a lot of 400s, so a lot of consecutive attempts by a developer to interact with our API, which is failing. So that's interesting. We can zoom in on this if we want. So in this case, we can say, okay, so let's look at the inputs that the developer is providing and also the outputs that he's receiving in his response. So in this case, we can see he's trying to post a pet to the pets API. The first call is failing because maybe he's not adding how old this particular animal is, and he's also not specifying the type. But he is actually getting error information on the fact that some information is missing, but he doesn't know what. So maybe for the second call, he's adding the type, thinking that that will solve the problem for him. And it doesn't, so he ends up in another 400. And then we see he's adding how old this dog is. But then he's getting a different error, which says there's some error in the input. Again, it's not very clear, so maybe he's changing the name because he thinks, okay, maybe there's already a dog called Gonzo inside, so maybe I have to change that, so that doesn't solve it. And then maybe he looks at the documentation and finds that actually, if he adds the ID, the chip ID for the dog, then maybe he needs to add a padding of zeros in front of it. So eventually he is successful, but if we see something like this, we could assume that maybe from a documentation perspective, we can actually improve this. And also from an error that is returned. So we actually have a lot of potential for looking at this data. For instance, we can look for all the example code that we provided and see whether our examples are actually being used. So we can search the data and see how many developers are using our example API calls. We can also see when they're doing this. Are they first attempting on their own? And if that's failing, are they then trying to use the example code, or are they never using it? Furthermore, we can see what is the response that they received for the example code, because maybe there's actually the example code is broken over time, because maybe there's some dependency on data. We can also see that. We can look for inefficient usage of our API. So maybe if we see the developer for every call is maybe adding a lot of data that is unnecessary, or maybe we see that he's using a refresh token for every call because he thinks maybe that's a better way to go. We can actually spot that, and before he goes to production, we can actually point this out, which will improve actually his own application as well as the load that we will have on our system. Yeah, we can also look at some common mistakes that are being made. So. If we see that for maybe some post operation on a resource, the item should be provided as a in the body of the message, we can see any post requests on an API which actually have an empty body. We can actually search for that and see how often that occurs. And if that occurs a lot, then perhaps we should improve on that front. We can also do some developer profiling work to see what kind of developers we are working with. So it's actually, this example that I mentioned is very clean data, just to prove a point. In the reality, it will be maybe a little bit more difficult to actually do some data selection, because we are interested mainly in the initial experience that a developer has, because that will show how he is able to learn how to use our API. So we need to see how we can select only that data. And the documentation, or the developer portal, or the API design itself, are probably not the only factors that will influence the results. So we also have to take that into consideration, that maybe a less experienced developer may run into a lot of issues that we can maybe not solve for him. But maybe we want to solve it. We can at least make decisions. So for us, next steps, we are now doing this based on dummy data. We really like to see actual data being stored, so we plan that in the next few months, and then see if we can see any patterns or any issues. We may also want to log data from the developer portal, so we can actually see whether a developer is mainly calling our API, or whether he's also studying the information on the portal in the first place. It would also be nice to do some before and after comparison, so if we make improvements, to see whether maybe the duration for getting a successful call actually reduces. We can do something on data augmentation, so now we can see developers only on the identifying, on the ID that we see in the events, but we can actually extract information from our own developer administration to see, for instance, what company they work for or what industry they're in. Splunk also offers some machine learning opportunities, so it's also one of the things we'll investigate. So the main purpose for this is to just to show the idea that we have and some implementation plans we have for this. It's very important that we get some feedback from you on how you feel, and maybe some other people have done this already, so we'd like to hear about that. So yeah. please contact me if you have any ideas or if you see any issues. Right.